and gentlemen, and honored guests, please be seated. My name is Linda Kutulis, and I am the city clerk. It is my pleasure to welcome you to Havel's inaugural ceremonies for 2016. On November 3rd, 2015, the voters of Havel gathered in 21 polling places across the city and elected 13 citizens to public office, including the mayor, 9 city councilors, and 3 school committee members. This morning, these elected officials will take their oaths of office and begin their terms of public service. The ceremonies today will follow a format similar to that used by the City Council, and a part of this meeting will be directed by the City Council President. I now officially call this meeting to order. Madam Sergeant at Arms and Messengers, will you proceed to the City Council chambers and escort the members of the School Committee to the auditorium? May be seated. Madam Sergeant at Arms, will you please proceed to the City Council chambers and escort the newly elected members of the City Council to the auditorium? We may now proceed to the rostrum. Will the audience please rise? may be seated. Madam Sergeant at Arms, would you please proceed to the City Council chamber and escort Mayor James J. Fiorentini to the auditorium? You may now proceed to the rostrum. Would the audience please rise? You may now be seated. At this time, I am pleased to introduce Father John DeLady, pastor of Sacred Hearts Parish, who will lead us in the invocation. Would the audience please rise for the invocation?
Let us pray. Good and gracious God, the community of Haverhill gathers this morning to celebrate new leadership. We invite your blessing upon the newly elected officials as they fulfill the responsibilities of their particular offices in city government. May you grant them wisdom and insight in the discussions and deliberations so that policies and decisions are made for the betterment of the citizens of Haverhill. May they have the courage and strength to make difficult decisions so that the community can grow and prosper. May the community of Haverhill work with their elected officials so that Haverhill may serve the needs of all its citizens and become a desired place to live, work, and enjoy life. May the coming year be filled with peace in our community, our nation, in our world. We make our prayer in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Father Delaney. It is now my pleasure to introduce Gerard Boucher and Haverhill school children who will lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Will you please remain standing for this?
Yes,
hello. Yes, on? Hello, can you hear? Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Mayor. Congratulations, City Council, School Committee, thank you very much. Please all rise. Those with hats on, hand salute. Without, put your hand on your heart. Thank you very much. On the count of one, face the flag. Thank you. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you very much and Happy New Year.
Thank you, Jerry.
You're welcome.
I am pleased to introduce the Haverhill High School Chorus, who will sing the national anthem.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so bright
you, Chorus. I will now read the record of the election of November 3rd, 2015, as it pertains to the election of mayor, city council, and school committee. You may be seated. James J. Fiorentini received 6,180 votes for mayor. John A. Mitchison received 4,444 votes for city council. Melinda E. Barrett received 3,878 votes for City Council. Andres X. Vargas received 3,835 votes for City Council. Michael S. McGonigal received 3,742 votes for City Council. Joseph J. Bevilacqua received 3,625 votes for City Council. Colin F. LePage received 3,405 votes for City Council. Mary Ellen Daly O'Brien received 3,374 votes for City Council. William J. Masick received 3,316 votes for City Council. Thomas J. Sullivan received 3,299 votes for City Council. Gail M. Sullivan received 4,535 votes for School Committee. Sven A. Amerian received 3,658 votes for School Committee. And Scott W. Wood Jr. received 3,613 votes for school committee. It is my honor to call forth Mayor-elect James J. Fiorentini to take his oath of office. Senator Ed Markey will provide remarks.
Thank you so much, and thank you for the great honor of having been invited here for this historic, auspicious occasion. It's a great day for the Fiorentini family, for Haverhill, and for the people of Massachusetts. And I congratulate the new members of the City Council, the new members of the School Committee. We need new people coming into government at all times. It reminds me of the story of the mother who took her two children into the zoo. And she called her children over and said, look down into that cage. The lion and the lamb are lying together. It's almost like a fulfillment of the biblical prophecy. Lying together, the lion and the lamb. And at that point, the zookeeper walked by and heard what the mother was saying. And the zookeeper said to the mother, "Hey lady, don't get too excited. We gotta put a new lamb in every day. Behold our new lambs who are here, ready to serve in city government." This is a great sacrifice and contribution which they are willing to make for this great community. And it's great to be here with Chairman Dempsey and Representatives Campbell and Bisaglio. We thank you for being here as well. This is an absolutely incredible day. President Lyndon Johnson once famously said, when the burdens of the presidency seem unusually heavy, I always remind myself, it could be worse. I could be a mayor. Because these days, mayors can have a job which is more challenging than ever. Budgets are tight, the need for services is high, and then there's Twitter. So anyone can comment at any time on anything that anyone is doing. But here in Haverhill, there is no shortage of challenges, but also opportunities. As the mayor, Jim Fiorentini has embraced both the opportunities and the challenges. And he's created an extraordinary success story for this city. He has revitalized the city's downtown, attracted business and jobs to the community. He took the abandoned Hamel leather factory and turned it into the mill's lofts, transforming the project into the largest investment in the history of the city. If you Google downtown revitalization, a photo of Haverhill comes up. He has been a Michelangelo to Haverhill's Renaissance on the river, and there is more economic development to come. When I visited the city of Haverhill right after I was sworn in as a United States Senator, it was on a Friday evening, and the mayor came back down from Seabrook in order to give me a tour of the city. And he was like Julius Caesar in his chariot, giving me the tour of this city that he loves so much, except that his chariot was a Ford Mustang convertible. And as we drove through the city, as he was pointing out all of the different redevelopment projects, all of the different transportation projects, all of his hopes for the children in the school system and to take care of the senior citizens, while ensuring that red tape was cut so that businesses could know that this was a city that wanted economic development to happen, and to happen at a very rapid pace. I knew that this was a man who had merged his identity with that of the city, which he loves so much. And so it is a great honor for me to be here today, to be asked to swear in this great mayor, because he is the very embodiment of all of the hopes and all of the dreams of all of the people who live in this city. He understands the needs of this community. He understands the opioid epidemic. He understands each and every aspect of what it is that is happening in this community. It is in his entire being on a daily basis. And so you have here the greatest Italian mayor since Fiorello LaGuardia. Okay? You have a man of history, a man who embodies all of the greatness of Haverhill. So I would ask the mayor to come forward so that I can administer the oath of office to him. Mr. Mayor, will you please raise your right hand?
I, James J. Fiorentini,
do solemnly swear that I will bear true faith and allegiance to the Commonwealth of Massachusetts and will support the Constitution thereof, so help me God.
Do solemnly swear that I will bear true faith and allegiance to the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, so help me God.
I,
James J. Fiorentini,
do solemnly swear and affirm that I will faithfully and impartially discharge and perform all the duties incumbent on me as mayor, according to the best of my abilities and understanding, agreeably to the rules and regulations of the Constitution and the laws of this Commonwealth, so help me God.
Yes. Do solemnly swear that I will faithfully and impartially discharge all of the duties incumbent upon me as mayor, so help me God.
I,
James J. Fiorentini,
do solemnly swear that I will support the Constitution of the United States.
Do solemnly swear that I will support the Constitution of the United States.
Congratulations, Mr.
Senator,
Mayor.
Thank you so much. Of course, Senator Markey's a hard act to follow, and I'm not going to try. I didn't think he remembered about the convertible. I love the story about the lions and the lambs. That was absolutely terrific. But good morning and welcome to everybody. It's a great honor to be here. Thank you all for coming out on this cold, wintry day. What a great city we have, and I'm so honored. Every term should have the same energy as the first term, but every term should have a little bit different, and every term should have a new vision and some new ideas. This morning, I'll announce some new ideas and a new vision for a new term. But first, I'd like to say some thank yous. I'd like to start with my family that have stood with me all my life, but certainly all my political career. And some of them are here today. My sister, Ann. My niece, Kristen, is somewhere. My wife, the first lady of the city. and my son James. Thank you very, very much for coming. Senator Markey, thank you. Thank you for your wonderful words, and I hope I can live up to them. I'm very, very honored by your presence here today. I can see why you're a United States Senator. You're a wonderful public speaker. Thank you for all you've done and continue to do for the city of Haverhill and for all you've done for the state. To our many public elected officials, state and federal, that have worked with us, that have been our partners, several of them are here today. I'm sure I'm going to miss somebody, but I'll try my best not to. Senator Markey, State Representative Brian Dempsey, State Representative Diana DiZoglio, State Representative Linda Dean Campbell, representatives from Senator Rice's office are all here. Thank you very, very much. It's been an honor to work with you. And I particularly want to thank single out the chairman of our Ways and Means Committee, our own local hometown hero who has been a partner with us in city government, Brian Dempsey. Thank you so much. I'd like to welcome and thank our clergy for being here today. The Imam is unable to be here, but representatives from Haverhill's Islamic community, Mahaban.
Jason here.
Oh, he is, okay. Thank you. Thank you very much for coming. We're honored by your presence. Father Delaney, representatives from the Armenian community, and Rabbi Coronel, thank you very much. Whatever your faith, whatever is your native tongue, wherever is your native land, wherever you've come from, ever since my grandfather came here a century ago, and even before that, Haverhill's had a long history of welcoming those who have arrived at our shores, and that tradition will continue. So for all of you here, from wherever you have come from, wherever is your native land, welcome. This is your city, or as they say in Spanish, bienvenido. This land is your land, esta tierra es tu tierra, and this city is your tierra, esta ciudad es tu ciudad, and you are welcome here, bienvenida. Welcome to all of you from wherever you have come. To our great musical groups, the Haverhill High Band and Chorus, the Sons of Italy Drum and Bugle Corps, welcome and thank you, the Constantino Chorus, thank you to all of you. We're joined today by a wounded veteran, who's come back to his city, and I want to welcome him back. A wounded warrior and one of our heroes, Matt Ray, welcome home to the city of Haverhill. I want to thank a wounded warrior from an earlier war who joined us and led us in the Pledge of Allegiance this morning, our own local hero, Jerry Boucher. Thank you for joining us. City employees in the audience. The success of our city is your success. I want to thank you for your hard work, your dedication, and the great job you've done. Thank you to all of our city employees. Thank you for your service and for being here today. At the end of my say that I want to thank the committee, and I do want to thank the committee that put all of this together, but one person in particular put all of this together today, did a tremendous job, my administrative assistant, Allison Hartquist. Thank you so much. And I'd like to thank her and David Van Dam, the two people in my office, for doing a wonderful job. And to my fellow elected officials, the members of the City Council and School Committee, congratulations. Congratulations on your election, and I look forward to working with you. And most importantly, thank you to all of you for being here on this cold winter day. I can't begin to tell you how proud I am to be inaugurated for a seventh term as your mayor, and how honored and humbled I am by your continued confidence. Thank you. When I first addressed you a dozen years ago, Havel stood on the brink of receivership. We had the lowest bond rating in our history, and we were tied for having the lowest bond rating of any city in the state. One of our fire stations was closed. There was talk of closing our gym, the public library. Our high school was on accreditation probation, and we risked being one of only two schools in the entire state with an unaccredited high school. Today, a dozen short years later, our bond rating has been raised 7 times, and today is the highest in our 375-year history. Today, our fire stations are all open. Our library has expanded hours. Our newly renovated high school is fully accredited, and today, for the first time in our history, 5 of our schools are level 1 schools. But the greatest change has been downtown. When I first addressed you, I laid out a plan to convert abandoned and polluted shoe factories to modern-day housing. Today, we have over $150 million of new investment downtown. Over 500 new housing units have been created, and 850 new residents have moved into our downtown, many of them young millennials. New downtown residents have sparked new downtown restaurants and new businesses. Downtown property values have gone up by $49 million. The number of people downtown with common victualers and liquor licenses has gone up by 60%. None of this happened by accident. It happened because we had a plan and we worked the plan. As President Kennedy said, things do not happen. Things are made to happen. It isn't just downtown that's benefited from this remarkable turnaround. Today, the median income in Havel is up by 28% from where it was a dozen years ago. Today, 4,000 more people are working than were employed in Havel 12 years ago. And Northeastern University economist Barry Bluestone said that of all the gateway cities in the state, Havel was second only to Chelsea in terms of job creation. But we won't stop there. The next time Bluestone measures it, we'll be first. The downtown boom didn't result as some people predicted it would in the overcrowding of our city or our schools. Our growth citywide is under 1% a year and is less than the state average. The widespread perception that Havel is growing too rapidly doesn't square with reality. Our school population in Havel has actually gone down. We have 800 fewer children in our public schools than we did a decade ago, primarily due to a declining birth rate. In short, the slow and steady growth of our city was exactly what was needed back then, and it's exactly what's needed today to continue our journey forward. Havel's done well, but the best is yet to come. Next year, thanks largely to Chairman Dempsey, the Harbor Place project will be completed. Next year, the Hunking School, and I want to commend our superintendent, Jim Scully, will be open. In a year and a half, the first phase of the rail trail will be completed, and the second phase will be started. The vision that I outlined to you 4 years ago of a series of parks and playgrounds along the river, that vision is becoming a reality. And today, there are investors interested in every single one of the few abandoned factories that remain in our city. Within a few short years, abandoned shoe factories in Havel will exist only in our history books. This is our time. Today, we no longer stand at the brink of receivership. Today, we stand at the brink of greatness and ready to build the city of tomorrow. But with every opportunity come challenges. The city of tomorrow that I see ahead is a city with good parks and playgrounds, a city that's safe, clean, and green, a city that keeps our residents here with good schools and an affordable tax rate and a great quality of life, and a city that attracts young millennials to move here and stay here. For decades, young people have moved out of Havel. It's time for us to attract them back. This is our challenge, the challenge of tomorrow, and it's a challenge we're well positioned to meet. All throughout the country, young people and empty nesters are rediscovering city life. One of the world's great experts on cities, Edward Glaser of Harvard, put it this way: cities have triumphed. People are rediscovering the cities are the healthiest, greenest, and richest places to live, and they're flocking to them. Not only are people rediscovering cities, they're rediscovering downtowns. cities are encouraging downtown residential youth because downtown has the least impact on our infrastructure. There are no new streets to build, no new water lines to extend, no new sewer pipes to lay. There's a tremendous pent-up demand for downtown housing, so much so that our housing projects are filled almost as soon as they're put online. But the millennials, the people that keep a city forever young, are being priced out of cities like Boston, Cambridge, Somerville, and Salem. This is Havel's opportunity. Today, for the first time in decades, we have a downtown that people can live in and want to live in. Havel is the affordable alternative. But if our opportunities are great, so too are our challenges. Our challenge is that to bring them here, there has to be a reason for them to come here. And once the old factory buildings are filled, and they will be soon, there has to be a place for them to move to. To make Havel the best city we can for our existing as well as our new residents, we need to make Havel what author Jeff Speck calls a walkable city. A walkable city is a city with good sidewalks, safe and clean streets, where it's a pleasure to walk to work, walk downtown, walk to parks and playgrounds, walk to public transportation, or just walk around a nice neighborhood. Sometimes a walkable city is a bikeable city, and every neighborhood needs a place where children and grown-ups can ride a bike. In a way, for those of us that grew up here, a walkable city is back to the future. Didn't we all walk when we were growing up? We walked to the playground. We walked to the neighborhood stores. We walked downtown to shop at places like Mitchell's and Garrow's and Barrett's and my grandfather's store, Gus's Market. We walked to church and we even walked to school. Now, we can't make Havel a more walkable city overnight. The first step is to make certain that in every neighborhood, every resident is safe and feels safe. And our job one is to make certain that our public safety progress continues. But beyond that, it will take millions to fix the sidewalks in the city and millions more to build more. This is our challenge, and we can't do it overnight. But the Chinese have an expression. The journey of 1,000 miles starts with a single step. This year, I'll propose that we take the first step to becoming a more walkable city, and I'll ask the council to join with me in investing more in our sidewalks than we've invested in decades. But having walkable sidewalks isn't enough. There has to be someplace to walk to. Over the past few years, with the help of our state partners, we've worked hard to restore our parks and playgrounds, and you only need go to GAA Park or Swayze Field to see that. But now we need to do more. Great cities have great parks, and my first initiative in this term will be an initiative I'll send to the council this winter to add a new park within walking distance of downtown and clean up one of our entranceways. Becoming a walkable city means encouraging people to live and work downtown. But today we have a new challenge, a challenge we never thought we'd have, finding enough places for people to live when all the factory buildings are filled. This challenge can be met by allowing and encouraging the building of new buildings, particularly on Merrimack Street. New buildings will bridge the gap between the Great Harbor Place project and the developments along Lock Street and Locust Street. New buildings will bring the vibrancy to the Merrimack Street end that the new buildings brought to the Washington Street end. Now, new buildings and new people, of course, bring a new set of challenges. Every opportunity brings challenges, but these are challenges we cannot ignore, but they cannot stop us from moving forward. We will meet those challenges just as we met the challenges that have faced us earlier. But not everyone can or should live downtown. The heart of Havel isn't downtown, and it isn't in the industrial parks. The heart of Havel is in its neighborhoods. And it's time for the neighborhoods around downtown to share in the downtown success. We need to work to encourage more growth and investment in the areas within walking distance of downtown, the Acre, Winter Street, River Street, the Mount Washington area, and along the riverfront in Bradford. We're seeing that investment now. This year, we have a tremendous amount of interest in investment along the waterfront, and we welcome that interest. But that new interest on the waterfront must always take into account our goals and our vision. Enable a view and a walkway to the waterfront. Create parks and playgrounds along the river, because the river belongs to all of us, not just those fortunate enough to own a place along the river. Building a walkable city means building a city with more jobs to walk to. For some residents, that means encouraging more jobs downtown. Bringing in housing can lead to jobs, but jobs are always the ultimate goal. We saw what happened in Lawrence when a single investor, Sal Lopoli, was encouraged to create jobs along the waterfront. We need investors like that in downtown Haverhill. But not everyone can work downtown. For some residents, a walkable city means being able to walk to the train station, and it means getting better train service to Boston. For other residents, a walkable city means encouraging neighborhood job zones, where places like Fantini Bakery can continue to provide neighborhood jobs to neighborhood people, just like they've been doing when my grandparents lived in the River Street area almost a century ago. For other residents, better jobs means expanding our industrial parks. It's time to look at our zoning laws to see if we can expand our industrial parks and make better uses of the parks we already have. It's also time to expand the capacity of our economic development office. A city of Haverhill starts by being a walkable city, but it isn't enough to attract people to live here. Once they get here, we have to persuade them of the great quality of life to keep them here. That's our challenge. Meeting that challenge means continuing progress in our schools. The schools are our future. We rejoice today in having 5 level 1 schools, but there's more to do. We cannot rest until every single school in our city is a top performing school. Now we know what works. What works is extended learning time, going to school a little longer, and studying a little bit harder. We need to make extended learning time our priority, and we need to give every one of our children a better chance to succeed. We also need to work hard so that we don't become a tale of two cities. We have a beautiful new school going up in Bradford, and we rejoice in that. But every child in every section of the city, regardless of their income or what their parents do for a living, every child in every region of the city is entitled to a top-flight school that's top-performing. And we're going to work hard in order to upgrade our schools and to do that. Haverhill's great success over the past 12 years didn't happen by accident. And building the sustainable walking city of the future won't happen by accident either. It will happen only with careful planning, and lots of input, and lots of public hearings, and meetings with our citizens. The plan we just received from Mass Development is a good starting point for discussion. Just like people often get second chances, cities sometimes get second chances. The plan that we have from Mass Development gives our city a second chance to undo some of the historic mistakes made by urban renewal. And it's an opportunity that we must seize. But planning has to include every neighborhood. Haverhill must continue to grow, but we need to plan for this. And we need to make certain that Haverhill's growth never takes away from the character and beauty of our city. It's time to take a look at our master plan, and it may be time for an update. Now, the vision I laid out today, the walkable city of tomorrow, will help to attract new residents, new jobs, help us to improve the quality of life for those who are already here. In our future, I see a city that's safe, clean, and walkable. I see a city with great schools, good jobs, good parks and playgrounds. I see a city that we're all proud to call home. We have a good city today, and our challenge is to continue our progress and build a better one. With your help, we'll meet that challenge. More than 50 years ago, John F. Kennedy said that government is not a set of promises, it's a set of challenges. So today I challenge you to join with us to build that greener, cleaner, more walkable city. Lend your city your hand, lend us your ideas, and lend us your energy. We've come a long way in our journey to make Haverhill better. Working together, we can take the next step and make Haverhill a great city. Thank you for coming and thank you for listening.
Thank you, Mayor Fiorentini. Now we will hear from the high school band and chorus and then the Constantino Middle School band with musical selections. Thank you. I guess the band isn't playing, so. I am pleased to introduce Rabbi Ira Corno of Temple Emmanuel, who will lead us in prayer.
Seventh term, huh? Mr. Mayor, thank you for inviting me to participate today in your coronation. Makor Chaim, source of all life, fervently we seek your blessing upon our city, its leaders, and its citizens. On this day of inauguration, we express our gratitude for the freedom which is ours to choose the leaders of our government. On this day of celebration, we ask your blessings for our city, for its government, for its mayor, members of the city council and school committee, indeed for all its leaders and advisors, and for all who exercise just and rightful authority. Grant them wisdom that they may administer all affairs of this city fairly, that peace and security, happiness and prosperity, justice and freedom may forever abide in our midst. Enlighten with your wisdom and sustain with your power those whom the people have set in authority. Inspire them with the spirit of your presence, and may they be guided by the values of our nation's founding fathers. Creator of humanity, bless all the inhabitants of our city with your spirit. As the psalmist wrote, Hine matov u'manaim shebetachim gam yachad. Behold how good and how pleasant it is for brothers and sisters to dwell together in unity. Thus may citizens of all races and creeds forge a common bond in true harmony, to banish all hatred and bigotry, and to safeguard the ideals and free institutions which are the pride and glory of our city, our commonwealth, and our nation. As we have empowered the leaders of the city of Haverhill today, we are filled with joy and celebration. We truly feel the exuberance of the psalmist. This is the day which the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be happy on it. We bless you, O Eternal One, ruler of the universe, who has given us life, sustained us, and enabled us to celebrate this joyous occasion. Amen.
Amen.
May be seated.
Thank you, Rabbi Cornell. I now call upon the newly elected members of the City Council to stand and take their oaths of office. Raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear that you will faithfully, impartially, with integrity, consistency, and fairness, discharge the duties as a member of the City Council for the City of Haverhill for a term of 2 years to the best of your ability, so help you God?
I do.
Congratulations. You may take a seat. I now call upon the newly elected members of the school committee to stand and take their oaths of office. Do you solemnly swear that you will faithfully, impartially, with integrity, consistency, and fairness discharge your duties as a member of the school committee of the City of Haverhill for a term of 4 years, to the best of your ability, so help you God?
Thank you.
We will now proceed with the organization of the City Council by the election of the City Council President.
I'd like to make a motion that we proceed to organize the election of the City Council President.
Second. I will now call the roll. City Council Barrett?
Yes.
Council Vargas?
Yes.
Council he's not here. Council Bevilacqua?
Yes.
Council LePage?
Yes.
Council Daley O'Brien?
Yes.
Council Masick?
Yes.
Council Sullivan?
Yes.
Council Mitchison?
Yes.
8 yeas, 0 nays, 1 absent.
I'd like to make a motion to nominate John Mitchison as City Council President.
Second.
I will now proceed with the roll. Councilor Barrett?
Yes.
Councilor Vargas?
Yes.
Councilor Bevilacqua?
Yes.
Councilor LePage?
Yes.
Councilor Daley O'Brien?
Yes.
Councilor Masick?
Yes.
Councilor Sullivan?
Yes.
Councilor Mitchison?
Yes.
8 yeas, 0 nays, 1 absent. President Mitchison, please rise so I can administer the oath. You solemnly swear that you will faithfully, impartially, with integrity, consistency, and fairness discharge the duties as President of the City Council of the City of Haverhill for a term of 1 year to the best of your ability, so help you God.
I do.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
We will now proceed for the election of a council vice president.
Move the nomination of Linda E. Barrett.
Second.
Motion by Councilor Masick and seconded by Councilor Daley O'Brien. Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Barrett.
Yes.
Councilor Vargas.
Yes.
Councilor Bevilacqua.
Yes.
Councilor Page.
Yes.
Councilor Daley O'Brien.
Yes.
Councilor Masick.
Yes.
Councilor Sullivan.
Yes.
President Mitchelson.
Yes.
8 yeas, 0 nays, 1 absent.
Are there any other nominations for this position? And now I seek a motion to elect Councilor Barrett as vice president. Is it? Okay.
All right. Discharge the duties as Vice President of the City Council for the City of Haverhill for a term of 1 year to the best of your ability, so help you God.
I do.
Congratulations. For the Council President, come to the rostrum to give his address.
Good morning and Happy New Year. Senator Markey, members of the state delegation, Honorable Mayor James Ferrantini, my colleagues on the City Council and School Committee, and city employees, honored guests, friends, family, and fellow residents of Haverhill. I also want to recognize my daughter Grace, who is here, who is a freshman at Haverhill High School. I want to take this time to welcome our two new city councilors, Councilors Andy Vargas and Joseph Bevilacqua. One brings a wealth of knowledge to the council, the other one brings a wealth of new ideas. It is an honor to stand here today as the president of the Haverhill City Council. Thank you for your support. I am grateful for the opportunity that you have given me, and I intend to have a major impact this term on your behalf. 2 years ago, at the 2014 inauguration, I recommended that Haverhill formulate a comprehensive economic development plan and begin to implement it. It is now underway. But let's review some of the recent accomplishments. Haverhill's business outlook, as the mayor pointed out, has come a long way in 2 years. We have started the construction of Harbor Place on Merrimack Street that will house UMass Lowell satellite campus. Thanks to state funding achieved by House and Ways and Means Chairman Brian Dempsey, and private funding from the Greater Haverhill Foundation and its partners, Mayor Ferrantini and Economic Development Director Bill Pillsbury, with the support from the council, have played a major role in implementing the transformation of this site. We also have temporarily increased our economic development capacity in two ways, again with the help of Chairman Dempsey. Mass Development is providing a full-time advocate and planner for 3 years, Noah Currents, to ensure that we succeed with Harbor Place and leverage it to revamp downtown. Additionally, the Massachusetts Technology Collaborative, in partnership with the Greater Haverhill Foundation, is undergoing an economic development plan for the whole city. I want to give you my take on the preliminary findings of the economic development study. One is Haverhill's economy is small relative to its size. However, and this is very important, Haverhill's economy has grown by 13.2% as measured by jobs since 2005. By comparison, the statewide employment growth was 7.8% in that same period. So we have a goal in front of us, we have a challenge, but we're already starting to meet it. Haverhill has approximately 20,000 commuters daily, many of which commute to Boston and Cambridge and Route 128, which have world-class high-tech and life science economies. Another key point, retaining existing businesses and fostering early stage businesses are the most effective ways to grow a local economy, grow and recruit entrepreneurs. Build upon Haverhill's existing food manufacturing cluster and better leverage Greater Boston's high-tech and life science engines. Catalog and develop Haverhill's available commercial and industrial properties. Market Haverhill's strong attributes beyond our borders. And then, as the mayor mentioned, increase Haverhill's economic development capacity with additional resources. The need to ramp up economic development hasn't changed. We need to provide good jobs at all levels for Haverhill citizens. It's the most basic enabler of a fulfilling life and the most effective social program. We need millions of dollars by expanding the commercial tax base to continue our progress in reducing crime and drugs, especially the opiate epidemic, continue to improve public education, properly maintain our public buildings. Whittier Middle School and Tilton School are on my watch list. Finally, complete capping of the old landfill and fulfill traffic and safety improvements across the city. Sidewalks are a major need. Additionally, we have three major challenges that could raise wastewater rates significantly in the next few years. Combined sewer overflow, stormwater runoff, and let's finally tackle the odor problem in the Bradford neighborhood surrounding Haverhill's wastewater treatment plant. It is clear that we need additional revenue from economic development to help fund these needs and to truly stabilize residential taxes over the long run. There are several new ideas emerging in various circles in Haverhill that are consistent with the preliminary findings of the ongoing economic development plan. Here are a few of those ideas. A scale-up contest for startups is in the very early stages of planning following Haverhill's recent success in its initial startup competition. There are many startup competitions to contend with. Haverhill's unique approach will focus on startups that have matured and are now seeking help to scale up as a business. Winners will need to move their businesses to Haverhill to reap the benefits. Secondly, to attract forward-looking companies, Haverhill will need to make an investment in its workforce. Training adults and students with hands-on science, technology, engineering, and math, STEM, is an investment in Haverhill's social capital that matches the strengths of the region. This will require capabilities beyond what is currently available in Haverhill schools. This should be piloted in the Mount Washington and Acre neighborhoods as a measure to boost those neighborhoods. And finally, we should all be thinking out of the box and not be afraid of failure. One trend that is emerging worldwide is co-working space. Co-working spaces are community workspaces populated by freelancers, small businesses, and corporate telecommuters. What if we captured a small fraction of Haverhill's 20,000 daily commuters heading to corporate offices in Boston and Cambridge, Route 128 and elsewhere, at co-working space in Haverhill? Corporations are seeking ways to infuse a startup culture in their current static office environment. What better way for non-competing corporations to adopt a startup culture than co-working with startups? Corporations are also having trouble retaining and attracting millennials. Improving the quality of life with less commuting time is very attractive to them. Couple that with Haverhill's cool downtown, which is getting cooler, versus boring office space in a business park, and we may have a winning value proposition for millennials. My recommendation: economic development is very competitive and complex in an ever-changing global economy. It's obvious that one person cannot do it alone. Mr. Pillsbury knows his business. Let's work together and ask him what he needs for support and begin to fulfill those needs in 2016. In conclusion, I hope this brief overview of what could be in Haverhill's future is as exciting to you as it is to me. That it imparts energy and excitement and makes clear my commitment to work towards achieving these goals. Now is the moment. Let's get on with it together. Thank you all very much. Will the Council Vice President come to the podium and give her address?
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you all. It's really an honor to be standing here in front of you all today. As only the second woman to hold this position, and she was a remarkable woman indeed. And I'd like to thank Senator Markey for being here, and the Mayor, and our distinguished guests. My first 2 years on the Council have been kind of a breathtaking, learned by experience exercise, learning the ropes, meeting new people, and working with our excellent city staff, the council, the mayor. It has been fascinating. I've studied ordinances, zoning, budgets, and learning just what is involved in running our city. I ran for the council after many, many years of thinking I should try it. Friends and family urged me to run, and oh, how I wish I had listened to them earlier. I recommend it to anyone. We, as the City Council, are here for you, the citizens of Haverhill. We are truly citizen legislators. But we all have full-time jobs as engineers, lawyers, small business owners, salespeople, and nurses. And I see the Haverhill Council as a conduit to city government and problem resolution for all the people of Haverhill. It is the process of the job that is both rewarding and at times frustrating. The frustration comes from the impossibility to please all of the people all of the time. But we are available to listen, to be your voice, and to try to help. We all take this job very seriously, and while not all our votes can always be popular with everyone, every time, we work with an eye for the future, a feel for the present, and always a charge to do what is best for Haverhill and its people. Haverhill is a city, and we have city-type problems. Addressing these problems will take a concerted effort. We must expand our economic base for both job growth and property tax relief. We have to identify and tackle complex social and quality of life issues in our city. And we have no choice but to provide a quality education and vocational training for our children so they will be able to realize their goals and dreams. And we need to maintain an aging infrastructure in our city and its public buildings. Working together, the city must explore and pursue partnerships with private ventures, state agencies, federal agencies, and other communities to solve these problems. We can also engage our citizens to work through neighborhood and volunteer groups and organizations in helping us address these complex issues. Positive change can and will be realized. I believe Haverhill is on the verge of a great resurgence. The completion of Harbor Place is a perfect example, and if we look forward to more improvements in our downtown and throughout the city. These are sensational times for Haverhill, and our opportunity is now. I am excited, and I hope you are too. So let's work hard together for the great city of Haverhill. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I am pleased to introduce Father Vart Jazalian of the St. Gregory Armenian Church to offer the benediction.
Please stand for the prayer. Congratulations, Mr. Mayor, and City Council members and school committee members. You have a big job ahead of you. But remember, you have a bigger God within you and with you. Let us pray. Dervogormia, most good and gracious and loving God, your servant Jeremiah taught us to pray for peace in the city where we live and to pray to the Lord on its behalf. For in its welfare, you will find your welfare. Thank you for this city, a city that some of us have called home for all our lives and others for only a few weeks. Thank you for all that dwell in it, in every neighborhood, in every building, and on every street corner. Lord, bless our Mayor James Virontini with everything he needs to do everything that you require on behalf of everyone in this city, that today he has solemnly sworn to serve to the best of his ability. So help him, God. So help him, God, to faithfully execute the oath that he has just taken on this, the day of his inauguration. Look out from your holy dwelling place above and bless us with the will and the patience to seek out and to search for peace in every corner of the city. Open our ears that we may hear the voices of the silent. Open our eyes that we may see those who have been invisible. Open our hearts and our hands that we may give to our neighbors in need. Reward all of our public servants who have dedicated their lives to promoting the common good. God on high, give strength, health, and vigor to the mayor and to the entire elected leadership of our city as they take on an awesome and admirable responsibility, and strengthen their own families to care for those who care for us. We pray, Lord, that today, that under the Fiorentina administration, those most in need will have no lack, and those most prosperous will have no fear of sharing their good fortune, so that we might move even one more step closer to achieve the dream of that beloved community where all of us live as true sisters and brothers in peace and love. We ask all of these blessings in your holy name. Amen.
Thank you, Father. I'll now entertain a motion to adjourn.
Second.
There's a motion and a second to adjourn. Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Barrett.
Yes.
Councilor Vargas.
Yes.
Councilor Bevilacqua.
Yes.
Councilor Page.
Yes.
Councilor Daley O'Brien.
Yes.
Councilor Mason.
Yes.
Councilor Sullivan.
Yes.
President Mitchison.
Yes.
Eight yeas, zero nays.
We are now adjourned. I do have a couple of quick announcements. I declare that this meeting is adjourned. Would the audience please wait until the elected officials are escorted from the auditorium? And there will be a reception in the mayor's office providing food and refreshments on the first floor. Thank you very much.